live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. We got him back again. Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene is back with us. He is a Pan-African historian, a best-selling author, star of the hit movie Out of Darkness, and renowned as one of the historical experts in all of the four-part series of Hidden Colors. Professor Kamene is also the principal facilitator and chief executive officer of the African-centered science academy named PERONC, which stands for Temple or House of Life. Welcome back, my friend.
My brother, I appreciate you. Thank you for inviting me back, my brother Philippe. I'm happy to be here.
And I can't be more ecstatic because I have been chomping at the bit for this show. I couldn't wait. And the reason I couldn't wait, well, there's many reasons, but one of the reasons was when I saw Out of Darkness, produced, directed by Amadeus Christ, and you are a narrator in the film, the narrator of the film, and you had a pivotal monologue or offered a pivotal monologue in the film Out of Darkness called only the best of the best could survive that or survive this. And that just touched me so much. As I told you in the green room, it resonated with me at the cellular level. And then further in the film, you talk about going from the pyramids to the plantation, from the plantation to the projects, and from the projects to the promised land, which is what this show is dedicated to doing. Can you speak to me and speak to the world how you came about these two incredibly life-changing monologues?
Those two monologues actually are classes, and in fact, series of classes. You could even call them unit classes that I teach, as it relates to the history of the African peoples in general and the diasporan African, particularly the ones that were taken from Africa, kidnapped, held in bondage, and enslaved. And so the first one that you spoke of, the best, only the best of the best, was a message that I always used to speak to my children about as it relates to tracking what happened to us as a people. Looking at this trauma that we are experienced and that we continue to experience even to this day. So the idea of only the best of the best came out of, we hear and people say all the time, we come from royalty. And while I agree with that, I believe I, as a teacher, early childhood teacher, and a teacher in general, I know that education really is shaped, defined by definitions. So what is royalty? So we see royalty. We see royalty with crowns on their head and families in line that bequeath to their children the throne. But that's not African royalty for us as a people. Royalty is our conduct and how we've conducted ourselves. The proverb is, you know, it's not what happens to you in life that's important. It's what you do with what happens to you that's important. It's like saying, you know, it is not what someone calls you that's important, it's what you're willing to be, is what you're willing to answer to that's important. And so only the best of the best tracks our history here, specifically in America, the United States of America, but also in this diaspora from Alaska in the northernmost part of Canada and part of the United States to the Tierra del Fuego in South America, the tip of South America. What has been our experience as it relates to post-1492? So I try to demonstrate how great we really are as a people. And I start off with the fact that we're children playing in our neighborhood. And we're running back and forth. And, you know, we see our elders off to the side, making sure everything's all right with us. And we're not hurting ourselves. And we're playing and we're learning and we're eating and we have all these different activities that we're going through, very comfortable and very safe. Generations have gone through this. But all of a sudden, a group of people that look not like us come into our community and they snatch us. Now that's a traumatic experience just there. only the best of the best could survive that onslaught of attack, ambush. They dragged these groups of people with them across with chains on their necks and on their feet, and they're speaking a language you don't understand. You're going to places that you don't know where you are. You know it's close to where your village is, but you don't know where it is because you've never ventured out that far. Only the best of the best could have survived that. They march you across for untold amounts of miles, and they put you in a dungeon that you have never lived in before. You didn't even know these types of things existed. They didn't exist where you came from, so this is all new to you. And only the best of the best could have survived something like that. And then out of that, they pull you up, they put you on a boat. Now, I'm missing out all the times that they beat you. I'm missing out all the times that they may rape you. I'm leaving all those pieces out, but that's happening simultaneously, if not directly to us, but to people around us, and we are actually watching this. This is a traumatic experience for us. This is redefining the way our DNA is set up. It's reassociating our neurons. And so on this boat, they take us across untold amounts of miles. We don't even know where we're going. And we end up, and that is where they torture us. And they force us to decline being called Kunta Kinte. They make us be called Toby. That was the breaking point, so-called breaking point, for the African children that were stolen from Africa. Only the best of the best could have survived that. And then, of course, we're on the plantation, generation to generation, treated as, in a way that we have no idea. We have never even imagined that we could live under these types of conditions before. Only the best of the best could survive that. What doesn't kill you is going to make you stronger. And then they so-called free you. And within a decade, they now put laws on you because you really did try to make it in Reconstruction from 1865 to 1877. You really did try to make it. But then they're afraid. So they begin to have Jim Crow laws on you. They begin to have sharecropping on you. They begin to torment you. And then comes the birth of what always was alive but just didn't have a name, came to be known as the Ku Klux Klan and the White Knights. And they terrorize you by night. There are laws where you got to be out of town by sundown. And so for all those years, we live like this. And then we come up north, and we are then exposed to a new type of white supremacy and racism, which is the liberal racism and white supremacy, the benign neglect. Yet still we struggle to make good with our lives. Only the best of the best could survive that. And now we find ourselves in 2015 on the University of Missouri, in Ithaca University. We find myself on my campus in State University of New York in New Paltz, fighting to keep the Black Studies program alive. But we have great strength, my brother Philippe, because we come from a long line of kings and queens. Harriet Tubman was a queen. We have our Frederick Douglasses, our Malcolm X's and our Martin Luther King's, we have our Fannie Lou Hamer's, we have our long line of royalty. So when we tell our children you are from royalty, that's the type of royalty that I'm talking about. The indomitable, resilient spirit of liberation and emancipation. That's what we're made of as a people. And that's what they're afraid of. And that is why they don't want this information, our understanding of ourselves in our educational system. And of course, now Black Studies is one thing, it's wonderful, but to first be introduced to your culture and your history in college is equivalent to giving a marathon runner a glass of water at the 24th mile.
Nice.
We need this information with our babies in pre-kindergarten and kindergarten. They need to see pictures of themselves in successful positions in the first and second grade. They need to start reading books that reflect their glory, their history, their values, interests, and principles. They need to learn the languages that they spoke prior to being enslaved. But no matter what, only the best of the best could have survived that. And here we are, still doing our thing, being hunted down by security forces, and sometimes, unfortunately, even some of us hunt our own people down. Yet still we rise. And so that story of only the best of the best was meant to substantiate and help us understand as a people that what you hear about black folk just isn't true. Mm-hmm. What you see in television, you come from royalty. You come from people who put everything they had on the line to make it better for you. Yes. And we have no right not to continue this. Absolutely. And that's what I've dedicated my life to. Only the best of the best. I expect the best from the best, as I tell my own children and the children I come in contact with and our people. I expect only the best from the best, and you are the best.
When I hear this from you, as I heard it the first time, you know, thank God I'm a talk show host, because otherwise I'd be speechless. You have to take it in, people. You have to hear this and you have to take it in. I, as you know, had an interview with and featured on my show, Dr. Gregory Smithers, who wrote the book and did the research, Slave Breeding. We talk about, another very dark part of slavery in our history. And he got a lot of backlash for it because a lot of people did not want, the powers that be didn't want that book to come out and that story to be told. But we were bred to the degree where we went from 1.1 million to 4.4 million in a 10-year span. When slavery ended, and that those 3 million slaves, 4 million slaves that were freed, that came from being bred. And when you think of breeding, social engineering, along with what we endured coming here to America, being snatched and brought to America, you are absolutely right. Only the best of the best could possibly survive that. But here's the rub. When you breed the best of the best, that was already the strongest race on earth. We are already the strongest race on earth because we survived 339 years of chattel slavery and then the Jim Crow, and we already survived that. Then going back, we were bred to be even stronger. Yeah, there's a reason perhaps for other people to have a huge fear of our knowledge, of our education, of ourselves, of our true history beyond, before slavery. That's one of the, we always have, and I had Dr. Myron Haley on and Roots, and we talk about slavery, but most black folk need to know our history before that so that they can understand who we really are, because right now, today, wherever you are, you could be in the worst living conditions, you are still, because you are standing, the best of the best in the history of humanity. Speak to that. Epigenetics is what we're talking about.
Absolutely. And the point that you're making, remember a couple years back, Jimmy the Greek?
Mm-hmm.
When he came out with that statement saying that why blacks were so great in sports was because they were bred to be physically superior. But you see, it wasn't just that. And he was removed immediately because never let out.
Yeah.
And really, not only did they breed us to be physically superior, but by the nature of the way they conducted themselves and bred us, they also created a spiritually superior people.
Absolutely.
And absolutely, a mentally superior people. For that's us right, to have to hide to learn how to read. The story of Frederick Douglass.
That's right.
And how he learned how to read. He used to go into town with breadcrumbs. and he would bet the little European boys, little white boys, I bet you I know more letters in the alphabet than you. And they say, you don't know no. I see they're children, so they don't know. And so he would write down in the dirt, A, B, C, let's say. And say, oh, man, I know more than that. They say, here it is, D, E, F. And he'd look at that. He said, okay, I got three more, A, B, C, D, E, F. Okay, come back tomorrow. I'm going to come back tomorrow or next week or whenever, and I bet y'all know more letters in the alphabet than you. And see, for hungry white boys, them breadcrumbs was good.
Right, right.
Okay? And he specifically picked poor white boys to do this with as a young black man himself. So long story short, he eventually learned the alphabet by betting them breadcrumbs. And that's why I used to tell our children, when I used to tell this story about Frederick Douglass, and when I talk to our people, it doesn't take a lot of money to become intelligent. Because Frederick Douglass did it on breadcrumbs.
Nice.
And so it takes a yearning and a desire. And when our ancestors on the plantation would hide at night and study in the dark to learn how to read, to learn how to write, they were bred to become intellectually superior to people who studied in the light.
Absolutely.
So we were bred, the very nature of the conditions that we have lived under, as horrific as they may be, when history records this event a couple of millennia from now, this experience will actually become the blessing and probably will have created the people who will get this human family through another dark age.
Absolutely.
Because the lights are coming down on the world right now.
Absolutely. Let's talk about that. We in one of the most popular shows, and I have to put this out here, your show on the epigenetics of humanity, of coming from Africa and how white people turn, black people turn white and white, and it's going back to brown, became the second number one show I've ever done, second to Robert T. Kiyosaki. And that's enormous. It lets me know that there is a huge surge and desire and yearning for this information, for facts, for truth, for science, for who we are. That's the question of humanity, right? Who am I? Why am I here and where am I going? When we talk about epigenetics, Professor, talk to us about how the brain, the neurotransmitters, the neurons, the axons, the dendrites, all of that good stuff. Talk to us about how the best of the best became not just spiritually superior and mentally, but literally our brains neurologically, because, you know, one of the misnomers that has been fed to us is that, you know, we have smaller brains, we are less intelligent, all of the yada, yada, yada. We've heard that for years. We now know that that is, of course, absolutely not possible just because of the epigenetics of what we have gone through and what we've overcome and what we've been able to sustain. Talk to us about the neurobiological component and aspect of who we are.
When you look at and you go back to the story of only the best of the best could have survived, let's go back to the part of the story where we were amongst our own people laughing, joking, and living a life that generationally we came down to understand. The brain's neurons, the nerve cells in the brain, are connected. It's called association. The neurons are living in a state of association. You are associating the foods that you're used to eating, the people that you know, your customs, your mores, your laws, the people around you, your environment around you, the animals that are in your particular environment, wherever it may be. Your brains have created an association with your existence. When they snatched us away from our own community, they did what's called disassociation, which they ripped all of those connections. they rip them from the connections that they were connected to. So in so doing, and I want to add this also, in ripping those connections, those wires away from what we were used to, what we were associated with, there were pieces of those memories still attached to what was ripped away. When they brought us here and put us in this position of being enslaved, dehumanized, no legal right to exist as a human being compared to the chattel, that is called reassociation. So you go from association to disassociation to reassociation. And so our people now, African people, now have their neurons connected into a box that is not what they originally were associated with.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
And so, when we look at the way in which we conduct ourselves, from possibly being willing to murder each other, to disrespecting our women, to disrespecting our elders, to maybe not creating the kind of economic security that we need to for our own survival, purchasing things that we really don't need, living the types of lives that some of us living, well, I think that's natural. Because when you have been taken out of your natural environment and you are put in an unnatural environment, then it is only sensible that you'd start acting unnatural.
Nice. Well said.
Very brother, Philippe, I tell the story all the time about, you know, they talk about the crabs in the basket.
I'm sorry I had to laugh at that because it was just so powerful and poignant. You know how you just sometimes, your mama just slap you up beside the head. Boy, yes. That's what that was just in that moment where you said, well, of course we're acting unnatural. We're not in our natural environment. Oh,
that's it. And to tell the story, an analogy, because, you know, as a teacher, you learn to tell stories, particularly when you're with children.
Sure.
And so the story I talk about is the crabs in the basket. Everybody talks about crabs in the basket and how we as a people pull each other down. However, if you took that basket of crabs and returned them back to the water, crabs actually live a life where they sit on top of each other so that the one on the top can get the food to eat. When that crab on top has dined sufficient, it then goes down to the bottom and becomes the bottom crab to bring the next crab up to eat. So in their natural environment, crabs work together to survive. But when you take them out their natural environment and you put them in a basket, they start to act unnatural, which in that world is natural.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is why, and I've never said this on air, but I'm saying it now. This is why I have this man on the show. He is a badass. He is it. This is why I love you so much, right? I swear to God. Now, honestly, and I'm not you know, pandering to you. I just think that, you know, I believe God has blessed me with a skill and a gift, one, to be able to bring on my show the best of the best, but to be able to ask the questions that bring out the best of the best in that guest. And you as a teacher, as an educator, you know, spending, what are we, we're only 25 minutes in. Some people watching this, just this 25 minutes, have learned more than their entire years of college in Black Studies. Mm. Because it's so powerfully profound that you just explain what's known as the slave mentality.
Yes.
The slave mentality is, why are we killing ourselves? Why are we pulling ourselves down? Why are we hating on each other? Where does this concept terminology come from? You so eloquently gave this story about the biological story of crabs. Take them out of their natural environment. This is how they're going to act.
Yes.
Unbelievable. I interrupted and interceded only because I had to give you some praise. Please continue.
Well, no, I really appreciate, you know, my being able to come, because no matter who I may be, no matter what I may know, if I don't have the opportunity to come on to a show, a successful show such as yours, then I'm only halfway there. There's a difference between being effective and being efficient. You allow me to be efficient. Mm. Effective is when you can impact 20 people in a room. Being efficient is when I can reach your audience. And this word has got to get out, because it's also reflective of every other group of people who suffer because they are who they are. And suffer from humanity's inhumanity to humanity. And it comes out of insecurity and inferiority. Because if you're really strong in who you are, and if you're really proud of who you are, while you can admire everyone else who may have far more than you, you are just content and happy in your life. You are proud to be who you are. And when people are proud to be who they are, Brother Philippe, wonders to behold.
No question about it.
That's what built the pyramids.
Absolutely. Absolutely. One of the individuals that are leaders, experts that we both have studied for many years is Dr. Joy DeGry, who has been on my show and is coming back to the show. But she, we had a funny story, her and I, because of my development. I remember studying epigenetics and understanding what epigenetics is. And then I found out about her work, post-traumatic slave syndrome. And I remember reading how she went through, you know, basically hell and denial of people saying, you know, your work is not really valid, only to discover that when epigenetics came out, that her work and epigenetics were one and the same. You had an experience with Dr. Joy DeGry. You saw my show with her. You have done work under post-traumatic slave syndrome and understanding it. Talk to us about the trauma and the intergenerational trauma as it relates to post-traumatic slave syndrome and the impact her work has made on you.
Because of my work with children, it's important, because in my observation of children, I have noticed that adults create an entire way of thinking for children in their own homes. The things that you say, how you act, the things that you laugh at, the things that you frown at, you shape that child. I was first introduced to Dr. Joy DeGry somewhere around January, February of 2001, when she was invited to a church here in New York, Abyssinia Baptist Church, to speak. She spoke on the post-traumatic slave disorder. I first had the cassette tape. In those days, we were dealing with cassettes.
I remember.
And I listened to the cassette tape. Later, I said, I got to get the video, because I need to see the way the sister's talking. Because her movement and her facial expressions, because I'm somewhat visual, is going to give me another way into understanding this. I was so impacted by her. The Per Ankh that you spoke of was in its first year in 2002. We started the Per Ankh in Harlem, New York, February of 2002. And I had been so impacted by her work. Many times we took the summer off. But because my schedule and the curriculum was so structured, there was no place to put this information. And I said, no, we have to put this information in. So we had an 8-week session in the summer dedicated to the post-traumatic slave syndrome. However, as a teacher and definitions, I didn't want to jump into the book right away. What I wanted to do is I wanted to study trauma. What is trauma? Because we can talk about slave disorder, We can talk about trauma, but if you don't know what trauma is, then everything else is going to be for naught, because you may say, oh, I suffer from that, but you don't know what you're suffering from.
Sure, sure.
So if you just study trauma as an event and you build from that, then there's a whole bunch of other things that can come. So in 8 weeks, we did the history of trauma. We did the geography of trauma. We did trauma as it relates to World War I, World War II. So we studied trauma, period. Then we introduced what happened as it relates to pre-trauma, trauma, the traumatic event, and then what is post-trauma. And Dr. Joy Degree was featured in the University of Virginia at Richmond, Virginia yesterday. There's a young organization, Rise Up. And last night, it's interesting that we would have this conversation today. Last night, she was featured in the documentary, Post-Traumatic Slave Disorder. And they called me knowing that I had spoken to them about this when I visited their campus. I spoke to them about this, and they asked me if I would spend 15 to 20 minutes outlining the important things as it relates to what they were about to experience watching this. And so I outlined it. And one of the things that I said that is so very important is to own, to recognize in you what comes from the experience of enslavement, as opposed to what happens to you simply because you are a human being on this earth. Because you'll find that many things that you do, many things that you react to, come out of the fact that you are carrying those messages that were given to you when you were very young. A lot of the fears. Like one of the things I did with my children, particularly my son, is if I took him to the store, if I took him to the mall, or when I took him out, I let him go. I let him be free. I stayed with him. I watched him. Many of us say to our children, hold my hand, stay by me, don't move away from me. Well, what we don't realize is that we are instilling the fear of existence in our children from that young age. Yes, tell them to be careful. One of the proverbs my children will tell you, I always told them, be aware of your environment. When you're in the street, about when you get maybe every third of a block, look around. Because when folk are going to come on you, they're coming on people who they see and watch and study that you never turn around. So they know they can move up on you without you ever turning your head around to see they're coming on you. But if they see that you're willing to look around, you're not a likely candidate that night. So be aware of your environment. But let them be free. Let them explore the world. Don't instill fear. There are many things that we do with children that instill this enslaved mentality. Like one thing I never told my children is to behave because I'm going to tell the policeman. That's the worst thing you can tell a child. Because if you need to get the policeman to make your child do the right thing, what does that tell you about your capacity of authority in your family? Particularly if you're the father, but specifically if you're the mother. You never tell a child to fear the police or to be aware of the police or to obey the policeman before they will obey you.
Absolutely.
See, we are setting this up in our children. These are little things. That are throwovers from the days of enslavement, because again, why did we tell our children? Because the police were already instilled fear, and a lot of what's happening in the communities today as it relates to the inappropriate behavior of some police is the one thing they'll say is, obey me, do what I tell you to do. Even if it's the wrong thing, do what I tell you to do. That is a slave master's mentality. And that is why a lot of African folk are now pushing back on that. Because a lot of black folk, like folk tell me, you know, They say sometimes things I say, things I do, they say, you out of your cotton picking mind.
Cotton picking, yeah, yeah.
And I say, yeah, I am out of my cotton picking mind. The problem is that you're in a cotton picking mind.
Hello. Bring it.
Many of us are walking around in a cotton picking mind.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
I'm out of my cotton picking mind.
I know that's right. I ain't picking no cotton. Love it. Love it. Love it. Yes. All right. So we're talking epigenetics, ladies and gentlemen, with Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. And in this conversation, Professor, of epigenetics, we understand what it means to be out of our cotton picking mind, to remove ourselves from the slave mentality, the slave mindset, the epigenetics, the intergenerational, trans-intergenerational trauma of slavery. We talk about the neurobiological aspect of this, but you also have mentioned to me, and you have done work on this, obviously, of the power of sound, our light body, understanding afterlife and eternal life, and how we are star people. We are subatomic particles made manifest into this human body, carbon, imprint. And I want you, because we've gone through quite a bit here, but I want you to bring us to who we are astrologically, right? Who we are as cosmic people, because we were the first on the planet. What does that really mean when we're coming from the pyramid and going back to the promised land? This is a cosmic journey. Speak to us about that. And Alea Dow, I also remember having on the show, and you were interested in some of the work that she was doing. Make the connection and connect the dots with us on that.
Yeah, you know, when she mentioned the light body was what drew my attention to it. There's a brilliant scholar by the name of Dr. Edward Bruce Bynum. And he's written two books. One of them is The African Unconscious. And the other is Dark Light.
Mm-hmm.
And in combining science and all of the other pieces, we know that as it relates to our cosmic existence, there are four major forces: electromagnetism, gravity, and the weak and strong nuclear force. These forces are reasons why, upon conception, we were forces of energy. We were light bodies existing all places in all time. When our mommy and daddy got together and that big bang occurred, that light body was captured. The electromagnetism, the electricity of our daddy's spermatozoa, the magnetism of our mommy's egg, in combination through the forces of gravity, concretized and captured this cosmic spirit into this thing, this tomb, this temple that we call our body. We existed before the Big Bang. We existed as a product of the Big Bang, and we will live after we have removed ourselves from this, because that's where the word liberal arts came from, because our ancestors in Egypt and Kemet, they believed that in world study, in study of self, self-knowledge, that you would liberate your soul, your ba, from the jet or this physical body. This physical body belongs to the earth, But the essence of who we are, our ka, belongs to the cosmos.
Absolutely.
And so it's like an ocean of water and a drop of water from the ocean. Mm. Upon conception, we are drawn from that mighty body of water as a drop. And the question becomes, what part of this drop of water isn't the ocean?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And what part of that ocean is not in the drop of water? So that when we say that we are God having a human experience, mm-hmm. we are saying that we are a part of the great cosmic ocean that has now become a microcosmic ocean.
Absolutely.
And that death is really not a bad thing. In fact, it's actually, as Dr. King has as an epitaph for him, free at last, free at last, thank mm. God Almighty, mm-hmm. we're free at last.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So to our ancestors, death is not and should not be something feared. It should be something that is part and parcel of eternal life. There's no before life and afterlife. There's just eternal life and all of the levels and experiences that this eternal life is going to go through. And our ancestors understood this.
Our awakening part of our human moment is just a little glitch, a blip.
Yes.
in all of this, people don't understand and recognize.
Absolutely, because see, we put too much value in time,
mm.
and not that time doesn't have its value, but everything ain't about time. The only reason why we have time is for us to be able to record and live this earthly experience.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so this is why Edward Bruce Bynum speaks in his book Dark Light. He speaks of the fact that a cosmic being on Earth is six-dimensional. When you are materialistically inclined, you're three-dimensional. Height, width, depth. But with the advent of understanding your cosmicness, your light-bodiness, you also understand that the fourth dimension that we live in is time and space. The fifth dimension is light. We live in the light. We live in all time and space. This is why people say, oh, that's deja vu.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, the idea is that, the story has already been written.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like a book that you receive and all of a sudden you read something in chapter 8. But chapter 8 was written in the beginning when that Akashic record was first wrote.
Absolutely.
So deja vu is only recognizing that you were destined to experience that because it was already written in the book.
Absolutely.
And so the sixth and final dimension that you're dealing with is gravity.
Okay.
And gravity is what keeps us as earth beings on the earth. It is a combination of the twins, centrifugal and centripetal forces. One that is drawn to but is constantly pushing out, and the other is pushing out but constantly being drawn in. The balance of that, the ma'at of that, is gravity. And that's why once you go in space, you start to float. Because you're at zero gravity.
You are unbelievable. I mean, this is, ladies and gentlemen, this is why I wanted this to be done today, to record this level of history, if you will. Because this is the understanding of from the pyramids. From the pyramids is not just our earthly beginnings on this planet. It's our cosmic destination, our cosmic reason for being in existence. That's where I wanted this to go, and what I wanted you as listeners, viewers, to get and to understand the journey, so that it's not, so we went from the pyramids to the plantation. We talk about slavery and Jim Crow and what that means and what that did to us epigenetically. Then we went through the projects where we are, if you will, now in terms of white supremacy, police brutality, the things that we're dealing with right now today. It's not that we're living, some of us, I came from the projects, but some of us live in the projects, but the projects is also a current state of being in this particular continent. But going back to the promised land is that cosmic journey that you're talking about, Professor, and that is going back to the light body and who we are. So that is unbelievable. 50 minutes of the entire journey of humanity and the deepest understanding that I have ever encountered that most people spend a lifetime trying to figure out and find. Thank you for that.
No doubt, my brother. And I guess our time is sort of kind of winding out. So I just want to, if I may, end with this. Our Creator, in looking at those that were born with a pyramid mentality, wrote books. And they wrote books about heaven, Amenta. They called it Amenta, the hidden land. And they spoke about the netherworld or the underworld or the world that we might call hell. And they fantasized what it would be like if we did not live in that beautiful world. We call it hell. And the Creator looked at us in our divinity and said, you know, you all live in heaven. You talk about hell, but you don't know hell. For you to get where you need to get, for what's about to come on the earth, we are going to create a situation where we're going to take a group of y'all out of your pyramid mentality, and we're going to place you in hell. And we're going to let that DNA, remember we spoke about those pieces of DNA that once our associations were ripped from us, pieces of that memory remained on that. So no matter if they reassociated it or not, we still had the memories of that pyramid mentality. And so what is happening now during this cusp of moving from the age of Pisces to the age of Aquarius? What is happening now is that out of the group of the group, the best of the best, having gone through this hell of the plantation and the limbo or purgatory of the projects, we have the DNA of the pyramid builders. We have the memories of the plantation dwellers. We are living the life of the project inhabitants. But with that, we are going to move to the seventh layer of human being. We have moved through Australopithecus robustus, Australopithecus gracile, Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Homo sapiens, and Homo sapiens sapiens. This best of the best is going to lead the way for this new human family who will live on the earth, and they're called super sapiens. We were divinely touched to go through hell to return back to heaven, because once you know hell, you appreciate heaven even more.
Amen to that.
So we will get to the promised land. Dr. King was right.
Absolutely.
We will get to the promised land. And when we do, we will see him there. As Malcolm and Harriet Tubman, Imhotep, and all the other wonderful human beings who have made it possible, my brother Philippe, for us to be here. And I just thank them, and I live in their glory, and I bask in their light, because they were, therefore I am.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Professor, I honor you from the pyramids to the plantation, from the plantation to the projects, from the projects to the promised land. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what we do. I can't wait to announce that Professor Kaba will be coming out with his first book in the first quarter, probably in the next 90 days or so. And I suggest that you stay tuned, because of course when that book comes out, guess what? We're going to have you back to talk about this amazing work and the man who inspired you and that you're paying homage to in your first of a series of books that you're getting ready to author. My good friend, I love you, I honor you. Stick around in the green room as we sign off. But thank you beyond what thank you can mean or be, I don't have words for it, for not just coming on the show, but for that divine imprint, for that big bang to happen, for you to show up in the world at this time is so much needed and so much appreciated. And I am so humbled and honored that I have been able to grow to a level to be able to attract and have someone of your level on my show and in my space and in my life, and subsequently being able to share that with the world. Thank you sincerely from my heart.
Thank you, my brother Philippe. It ain't over till we win, brother.
Absolutely. Take care, everyone, from around the world, wherever you are. Thank you for tuning in. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live.